If you looked at a map of the world on a globe and you span it around to the Pacific Ocean, you would find it very, very difficult on the globe to see Kiribati. It'd be just a couple of little dots, 33 little tiny dots spread over the Pacific Ocean. The marine environment and the fisheries around them and inside the lagoons and offshore are critical, not just for food security or not just for economic development, but culturally, you know, an intrinsic part of the whole Kiribati identity. Last year, in 2013, the Kiribati government earned about $86 million from tuna fisheries revenue, you know, from joint ventures and dividends and access fees and all those types of things. That's about 60 or 70% of the entire revenue that the Kiribati government earned in 2013. So obviously, when you look at it that way, fisheries are really important. That's how the government pays for hospitals and pays for schools. But at the same time, Kiribati fisheries are absolutely vital to food security. The fish that people catch, and maybe they sell it on the market on the side of the road, or maybe they or someone in their extended family eats it, that's about 75% of what everyone eats every single day. And we have vessels from Europe, from Spain, from the United States of America, and all of the North Asians, and they come here. And this is the most attractive tuna fishery in the world. It's about 60% of the global supply of tuna. I'd guess, say, 500 or 600 vessels are probably licensed to fish inside Kiribati's waters. But across the Pacific Ocean, in the Western and Central Pacific, which is where Kiribati is, there'd be maybe 300, 350 purse seiners and thousands of longliners. The vessels themselves, the largest that catch skipjack tuna or yellowfin tuna that you'll see in a can. The smallest of those vessels we would call a purse seiner. And yeah, that's going to be around about, say, 50 metres. The next size would be what we call a super seiner. Yeah, it's an extra big purse seiner. Yeah, it might be 50 to 80 metres, maybe a little bit bigger, maybe 90. And then the really big ones, the ones that can get up to like 500 feet long or 144 metres long, we very originally call those ones super seiners. And you know, they are the world's biggest fishing boats. They're up there with the world's biggest trawlers. And they are just basically big industrial operating machines that are very, very good at catching fish. And they don't just go steaming, wandering aimlessly or randomly along, just hoping that the fish will turn up. They utilise satellites and helicopters, all the latest oceanographic data. They utilise fish aggregating devices with sonar buoys and all that equipment. And it's a very well-honed operation. And they are very, very good at catching fish.
I'd start fishing around the 90s, yeah, and I still fishing until 2005, and I stopped it. Those days, I mean, in the 90s, we catch a lot of fish. Almost every day in a week, we can catch not less than 200. I'm true about this. We always went out fishing and came back with a boat full, you know? Before, we can catch a lot of money from catching the tunas, you know? We can sell it out, we can eat it, we have enough for our family. But nowadays, they cannot really survive in this kind of our local way how to fish, you know? So I think they, maybe a few more years, they can still survive. But later, I think we cannot. If we still it's still like this, that's all ships are coming to take our fish away, then I think that's the problem. It will start getting bad and bad, you know? It will never getting better, you know?
Before we can have for one boat, they come back with almost 50 yellowfin, but that's among those three boats. But now they can come back with only 5, 3, 7, I figure like that. But with small tuna, they can come back with almost 100 over 100 last maybe 2 or 3 years, 4 years ago. But now they can come back with only almost 10. That's a big change. with their catch.
Now we are not the only fishermen in our ocean, in our sea, you know. We can see that now that we have a lot of ships, yeah, from other countries coming here and take maybe a lot of fish. That's why with the modern technique, with nets and something like that. That's why we cannot catch what we used to do.
They can come back without fish, and sometimes our fishermen say that they blame those ships coming. They use the long nets to catch fish, and they blame too for the tuna, because they catch the tuna too, maybe the small ones, so, and that's can cause the problem. When they went out to get fish, they return without. I feel very sorry for the people of Kiribati, because I know they rely on the fish for their food and for the money. Then they can use that money if they have lot of fish to sell, then they can have the money to support their family and for the education of their children.
Eh, na ngay na wala tayong kain na business yah tay sa kaligiran ng tapos kita tiyak wa. Tapos tay angin tay anapen rush. Ang tapos tay amanaman. Punangin dito tay kana pun. Kanga ibun si pun dua tay kina yah ita tayo. Kana arus. Awan na kapwa mina pangayon kan na mahapon duwata kina kapwa minta pa ngayon kan ang mga nungon na kawa kana arika kanay ngayon kana kan sipatawag kan min po ni min pa kana aro na pa ako.
There are really, really good opportunities, I think, in Kiribati to increase the participation of artisanal tuna fishers so that you get more money going, you know, more horizontally rather than going through a foreign fishing corporate company that then pays licensing fees and taxation and then gets distributed through government revenue. It's vital that Kiribati maintains its food security through fisheries. And ultimately that will mean that Kiribati will have to allocate part of those oceanic fisheries to food security. If you can do that and also be able to create something that can give people cash through employment, then that's fantastic. You've got to be able to do both.
They are making us worry, you know, worry about our kids in the future. We rely on the ocean. That's only our resource for us, the ocean. And now they are start getting more and more big boats coming. We will ask them to think also about us, not only for them, because we are the same in this world, you know. How can we survive later when the ocean is completely, for example, exhausted? I think we have no other chance to live, especially us, the Highlanders. We cannot survive without our ocean. Yeah, that's how we're going to say to them. If they can, they want to hear it, I think they will, because they will feel sad for us also. They will feel sorry for us if they know that we are the people of the sea. Yeah, that's all I think that's all I can say to those guys. Those big guys.